I am Lisa Shalit. Thank you all very much for coming to this Talks at GS with Linda Rottenberg, co-founder and chief executive officer of Endeavor, a nonprofit organization focused on catalyzing long-term economic growth by identifying, selecting, mentoring, and importantly, accelerating what Linda calls and will tell us more about high-impact entrepreneurs in emerging markets. The organization has provided nearly 1,000 entrepreneurs selected from a pool of 40,000 candidates with access to mentorship, professional networks, and capital. Their companies have created 400,000 jobs to date and generated $7 billion in revenue on 2013 numbers. And somehow she found time earlier this month to publish a book called Crazy is a Compliment, The Power of Zigging When Everyone Else Zags. Tell us about your personal story as an entrepreneur. How did you get going and come up with the idea to start Endeavor? What did you see and why?
Well, I actually grew up outside of Boston, and I grew up in a traditional home. My parents met as childhood sweethearts. My dad went on to become a lawyer. My mom stayed home and raised three kids. And my parents are incredibly loving and incredibly risk averse. And some of this risk aversion rubbed off on me. So I went to Harvard, then I went to Yale Law School, get to law school and realize I have no interest in practicing the law. So I took what my parents thought was going to be a year, went to Latin America, was in Buenos Aires, started dancing tango and rooting for soccer teams, and fell in love with the culture, but was surprised. This is now the mid-1990s when Netscape and Yahoo are happening. There's no talk of any young person starting a new business. And I thought this was strange, and then I was in a taxi in Buenos Aires and realized my driver had an engineering degree. So I had to ask him, what are you doing driving a cab? He said, well, the government's not hiring. And I thought, government? No, why aren't you starting a business? And he found this a strange question. And as we went back and forth, it became clear that at that point, there wasn't really a word for entrepreneurship in Spanish or then in Portuguese or in Arabic or in Turkish. Now they all exist, but 20 years ago, they really didn't as concept. So I had this sort of aha moment and said, what if there was an organization that supported big dreamers who could create jobs and wealth and change their industries, but in places where there was no support system? And could we find a way to nurture their risk-taking? But to do that, I realized I had to take some risk of my own. So I came back to the US, I connected with Peter Kellner, and we co-founded Endeavor at my parents' kitchen table. And we were plotting this global organization. My parents overheard, and they were not pleased. But this moment, I remember very clearly being a pivotal point, and it was one that every dreamer faces. Do I take the safe and the expected path, or the unsafe and unknown one? Do I choose fear or hope? And I not only remember thinking, I have to choose hope, I have to do this, but that I would then spend my life helping dreamers in similar moments when they were scared and stuck, get unscared and unstuck. And so as a way of explaining what I've done at Endeavor in the last 20 years, we now work in 22 countries across the emerging markets, but also in Europe and now the United States as well. And I say that I spend my life helping dreamers get unstuck. So that is the initial origin.
So the parents were sort of like, uh-oh, and you had an idea that you felt passionate about. Where did you get those supplements to your own passion and conviction? Where'd they come from?
It was finding the entrepreneurs. I knew that if we selected the right entrepreneurs, and you've served on one of our selection panels and know how rigorous it is, and I knew that if we had the Endeavor seal of approval meant something, then everything would flow from there. So we had to convince people to actually apply it first. And one of the first people we found was a young kid named Wences Casares, who had grown up on a sheep farm in Patagonia. And he had the idea to create the E-Trade of Latin America. And 34 investors turned him down. They said, this is insane. Our stock market barely functions. And why are we going to try trust a kid who grew up on a sheep farm in Patagonia? No, thank you. And we just knew he was onto something. And so he was selected an Endeavor entrepreneur. We got him a COO. We got him access to venture capital. We helped him with an international expansion plan. He ended up marrying my assistant. We are a full service organization. And 18 months later, Wences has sold his company for $750 million. I got a call from 34 of those investors saying, hey, anybody else you found?
That's amazing. So and those ideas you just expressed, is there anything else resonating that surprised you?
There are a number of things. I thought working in these markets that it was going to be financial barriers, structural barriers, or cultural barriers that held people back. And in fact, what I learned is it's psychological. And I think that's true if you're starting inside a company as well. One of the things that holds people back is say, I'm not this huge risk taker, and entrepreneurs are these swashbuckling mavericks who go all in and bet the farm. And what I knew from experience, but then what data supported as I was researching, is that entrepreneurs are risk minimizers, not risk maximizers. And I've come to believe that it is much more a skill set and a mindset that we all need. And that while taking some risk seems scary, the riskier strategy today is to take no risk at all. I really believe that unless we start innovating and taking some risk ourselves, that we're not gonna, our jobs will not be there.
That point on risk minimizing,
yes,
is I think just an unexpected, not intuitive point, a really interesting point, and I think hopefully helps all of us be more in touch with our inner entrepreneur. How do you find entrepreneurs? How, especially in, you know, all sorts of far-flung emerging markets where there might not be an infrastructure, or at least wasn't initially, for you to find them?
Well, first of all, we have a model for going into a country that we say is pull, not push. So we won't go in unless the top business leaders actually call us in, they raise $3 to $5 million up front, they agree to form a board, and they will help put their networks to actually supporting the entrepreneurs once Endeavor finds them. So just at the beginning, even the fact that they're paying attention, every entrepreneur's tentacle goes out and they've been trying to get, you know, to these people. We form local teams and we scour the country looking for high growth, high impact entrepreneurs. And what we say is we're agnostic about industry. These can be startups, but they have to be at a scale-up phase. We're not looking at them at the moment of startup, we're looking at them at an inflection point, so they have to have gotten some traction if they're a new company. We'll also look at family businesses. A lot of the emerging markets are these wonderful family businesses that get to about $3 to $8 million in revenues and get stuck. And that's when the next generation takes over and has a transformational idea, but there's no support. So we put entrepreneurs through a year-long process. And then 5 times a year, we have one of these international selection panels. And they have to get unanimous approval, which is really key. Because when they come out of here, not only are they getting a 3-person advisory board and access to a suite of services, but every capital provider that's operating these markets will say, who did Endeavor select? Everybody who's a potential supplier is looking. So it becomes very important. So I think what I've come to believe is that entrepreneurship can come out of anywhere. And in fact, some of the best ideas are the most obvious things that we see a need that's not happening and we just go about fixing it. I've come to believe that entrepreneur is actually a fancy word for saying you're a doer.
Well, there. That fits our culture quite well. And certainly broadens the definition, which is you know, makes it just much more accessible. Because I think we do all get caught up in the culture of those, you know, famed few who make it really, really big, and it's intimidating.
Yeah, and that entrepreneurship is also a series of mini innovations. I call them minivations. It's not necessarily the shoot the moon idea. It's about taking a big dream and breaking it down into small pieces and then moving it forward.
When you talk to entrepreneurs who are so immersed in what they do,
yes,
part of it's passion, and part of it is, you know, lean organizations where whatever a doer does.
Yes.
And so how do you counsel them on this? Because I would think if we are able to use the word imbalance, there is probably a lot of it that's very endemic to the kinds of folks you meet and the challenges that they have. How do you address that?
I think when you're starting up, everything is about you and your idea. And frankly, that's what you need to attract capital or teammates or suppliers. It's all about you. And if you want to go big, it can't just be about you anymore. It has to be about, you know, building people around you. But it takes knowing yourself and your strengths and weaknesses to know how to build teams around you. And I think that then leads to ultimately realizing you're not good at everything and you can't do everything and you can't micromanage. And that's what then leads to more of the flexibility and realizing, look, what's the point of a dream if you can't share it with the people you love? Mm-hmm. But I think it really starts with realizing it can't just be all about you and that you have to make others co-creators in whatever dream you have.
So the book talks about lessons learned from your personal experiences as an entrepreneur, as well as those entrepreneurs in which Endeavor has invested time and other resources over the years. So let me share a passage from the book, if that's okay. We picked one. So the quote is this: mastering the art of entrepreneurship is not simply about starting a business. It's about taking chances, overcoming doubts, managing risk, dealing with chaos, cultivating employees, coping with stumbles and successes, integrating work and family, and paying forward to ensure that the next generation can dream big as well. And it's realizing that all those people calling you crazy are giving you a huge compliment. Just, I mean, that about sums it all up.
Yeah, I think that we all have a choice today. We can either allow ourselves to see the world differently, to be slightly contrarian, to take some chances, to risk being, you know, called crazy, or we can do nothing and just hope that our jobs and our economies and our families are safe. And so what I did in writing this book was to give everyone a perspective of how they didn't have to risk it all, but that giving themselves that permission to take some risk is the way that they're going to get ahead. Today, 4 in 10 Americans will at some point spend time working as independent contractors for themselves. And so to be able to develop this skill set and this mindset is really what I hope people will take away.
All right, that's a great note to end on. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you.